I've got Blackmoor on my mind, or more specifically, the Temple of the Frog, which is the module contained in this book, the second supplement to the Zero Edition box set of Rules of D&D. And why does this old relic of those days still churn around in my brain pan? Well, at the behest of a longtime viewer, Matt Nerdy, he asked me to kind of go over this module, talk about maybe the lessons that you can learn in terms of homebrewing your own modules, and, you know, maybe even, you know, as I went over this, thinking about how you might be able to update that to a current campaign in 5th edition D&D. Well, when I did this, I got a host of comments from viewers, one of them, Vic Gonzalez, who I actually ran with back in the 90s in Hollywood, California. And Vic has gotten the Dungeon Draft mapping software after seeing one of my videos, and he wants to learn more about it. And he said, hey, maybe you could update these maps in the module into Dungeon Draft. And another viewer, Sirix DX, said that he'd like to see, you know, maybe me go over some converting of these, you know, the killer frogs or frogmen or some of the humanoids in this module to see how you do that to upgrade these to 5e. But, you know, I got to thinking about this, the overall change that I was envisioning of taking this module that, frankly, I think doesn't really work as written and, you know, getting rid of those aspects that don't work, updating it to 5e. Why? Because the concept is really cool. You have this force coming from another dimension to this nexus point between planes. They come to this dismal swamp and they find this temple with only a few old acolytes hanging on. And these planar travelers realize that they have an opportunity to revive the Temple of the Frog, to gain riches in this new dimension, but most of all, create a module for 5th edition D&D. Hello again, folks. K.R. King here, helping you homebrew your own D&D campaign. So today we're going to be talking about the Temple of the Frog from this original edition, trying to see how we might update this to 5e. And as I said, one of the reasons I really like this, doing this, is because this edition to me doesn't really work. I talked in the last video about scaling issues, way too many monsters. There's also all sorts of undefined powers of things. Things aren't organized well. And this lack of functionality actually gives me kind of free rein to just riff on this story idea. When I say riff, you think of music. If you've ever played music, when you improvise, what you're doing is you're taking the melody of the song and then using the chord changes that go in that melody and creating your own music based upon that. And it's the same thing here. The basic melody is the story, which is, you know, these planar travelers come upon this temple and take it over and begin wreaking havoc in the area. And the chord structure upon which I'm going to base my new story is the alien technology that this planar traveler brings to, you know, create these killer frogs and frogmen, to control the acolytes of the temple and bandits that he has assembled. And the improvisation are these changes that I make based on the game system mechanics of 5e and the changes based upon, you know, what players expect now in the modern world of 5th edition D&D. So in this video, I'm going to be examining some of the things based on the original story that I'm going to keep and some that I'm going to jettison to create a plausible module, you know, with Steven and his partner coming from this planar dimension to revive the temple. Then once I have, you know, all the stats of the various creatures here, in the next video, I'll be modifying the maps and creating, you know, placing all these forces where they would be, and then talking about how the players are going to encounter this situation. All right, so my first step is to drill down on our big bad villain, Steven the Rock, who is basically the first big bad villain of D&D. Now, Steven is never physically described in this original Blackmoor edition of Temple of the Frog, nor is his point of origin ever defined. So the question is, how does he appear? Is he a humanoid? You know, is he been transformed into humanoid, but he has some other form, some alien creature? So one of my basic principles of D&D is keeping things simple. So instead of having some complicated alien form that he has to transform, I'm just going to make him a humanoid that appears human. And then I'm going to add a little change. I'm going to give him dark vision. And part of this is he is from another plane, so he might have other abilities. You know, dark vision is very useful. You could do other things, you know, make his movement stronger or, you know, super hearing or long distance sight, something like that. This is just one I'm going to use. All right, so in the Blackmoor edition, it says that Steven has no magical abilities or powers. He relies completely on his alien technology. But they do say that he wields a +3 sword and a +3 shield, which are martial weapons in the 5e system. So I'm going to make him a fighter. Now, I have seen other people claim that he is a priest because He calls himself the High Priest, and this was one of the terms in the original books. But since they say clearly he doesn't have any magic powers, I don't think that's the case. So again, for simplicity's sake, I'm just going to make him the Battlemaster archetype. You may be tempted to create your own homebrewed archetype since he's from another dimension, or mix and match different ones, but you know what? I'm trying to keep things simple. And I'm going to make his level 7th or 9th, depending on the level of the group. And this is an important thing. If you're running, you know, higher level characters to do this, that's fine. I tend not to run much groups higher than, say, 10th level. That's a whole other story that I could get into another time. All right, so in my last video, when I was talking about Steven's battle armor, I used the classic drawing of, you know, the sort of futuristic battle armor, but I think I'm not going to do that. I think I'm going to have Steven looking like a fighter, you know, with armor and, of course, his shield and sword. He's still going to have the alien technology, but it's going to be like a power belt that he wears. This will provide him with all of the reduced capabilities in terms of spell resistance, some immunities from spells. His sword will be powerful, won't have the lightning bolts, some invisibility with his shield, this sort of thing. But, you know, it's powered here. And in the old version, it had 60 hit points, which I thought was a little weak for the tremendous powers that it has. But now it's just going to be an item. Obviously, if he blows his resistance against some energy spell and is killed, there could be a chance that this is, you know, destroyed or, you know, broken or something. But basically, it's just going to be like any other magic item. I also talked in that video about getting rid of this medical cube that cured one hit point a day, which I thought was a little weak. But I think I'm going to keep the teleport. They called it a communications device, but it's a teleport up to two people. Because Steven, you know, and his partner who have come from this plane, I think it gives him a way to escape if things get tough. And that brings us to Steven's unnamed, you know, associate in Blackmore. He's never given any name. Now, since he was made the captain of the guard with the control rings in the Blackmore version, I'm not going to have that. So I'm going to make him the leader of the bandit group. That's Steven, and I'm going to call him Barnabas, just a name I thought of off the top of my head. So Steven and Barnabas, you know, they've assembled this group of bandits here to exert their control over this, you know, town of sort of riffraff that exists outside the temple. And I'm going to make him a 6th or 8th level fighter, depending on, you know, vis-a-vis Steven's level and the party's level, and I'm going to use the champion archetype. And then under Barnabas, there will be the bandit captain, who will also have a control ring being controlled by Barnabas, and, you know, 20 to 25 bandits under the captain. All right, so you've got these two guys established. Now, what is their motivation? What are they trying to achieve here? And I'm going to get away from, you know, coming from a, first of all, they're not going to be aliens. They're going to be coming from a different plane. I'm getting rid of the two associates that were in the original module were killed before it ever started, so who needs them in a way? And instead, I am going to make these two soldiers of fortune. They stole a teleporter and went across through the Nexus Point and found themselves in the swamp. And there's a very famous short story by Rudyard Kipling called The Man Who Would Be King, and it's set in Afghanistan in the 1880s. These two non-commissioned British officers, Danny and Peachy, decide to go into the interior of Afghanistan where their technology, their weapons, and their knowledge will make them gods. And I would encourage you to read the story and especially to see the film with Sean Connery and Michael Caine. It's really good. And of course, they at first succeed. They know these Masonic rituals. It's a long, you know, kind of involved thing. But then their hubris makes them go a little too far and ends in disaster. So for me, these two soldiers in Kipling's story are the model for Stephen and Barnabas. They come here and they realize, hey, there's this cult here. Our technology is advanced. We have these rings of power that can control them. We'll go around and we'll collect booty from the towns all around the edges of the swamp. Once we've got enough, we'll just use our teleport device and move on to the next place. And this is the riffing, the improvising that I'm talking about. Taking the basic story or the melody and the basic components, the futuristic technology, the planar travel, and then riffing on it to improvise a story for the module. All right, so next you got to think about these priests. As I said, they were very old, kind of the last remnants of this, and I'm thinking they're druids of the land. And of course, their terrain would naturally be swamp. And they have been corrupted by Steven using these rings. These rings of power are the key to this module because they explain how Steven could corrupt these druids, how he could have this fanatical control, and his alien technology, never explained, of how he can use the druidic power, the shape change sort of thing, to create the killer frogs and the frogmen. And I would say this is somehow connected to the teleport device. Again, you don't have to go into too much explanation, just have said that they can create these frogmen. That's the fun of D&D. So basically these last, you know, druids here were just old curmudgeons who hated the influence of civilization, but they would never have gone to these levels, you know, creating these killer frogs and these, you know, abomination frogmen without Stephen's influence. You know, and there's two ways to treat these druids. One is the simple version, one is complicated. The simple version is they were stagnated in this swamp and they didn't go anywhere and they didn't really go up in level. So you could make, you know, they got six druids, you know, six priests of this temple. They're all second level. And then Stephen just has them around for their heal spells. Obviously at second level, they do have that shape change and whatnot. And again, they are under Stephen's control, as we'll get into a little bit later. The more complicated version is to have them at a variety of levels. The leader, say at sixth, two more at, you know, fourth, a bunch at third, something like that. The issue here, of course, is that now you're having to come up with all these characters, you have all their spell lists, what they do. Now, the fun is, if the players can come along and get these rings off these druids, they become powerful allies. All right, next we have to define the killer frogs and the frogmen that were in the original Temple of the Frog. And again, I'm saying that the original druids had nothing to do with this. This is purely from Stephen's, you know, alien technology. All right, now the only information we have in Blackmoor's Temple of the Frog on the killer frogs are 2 feet long. They have 3 hit points. And they move 90 feet on land and 120 feet in the water. They're told they have razor sharp teeth and claws, but no information on the damage it does. So if I'm going to do this conversion, I'm going to make the 2 foot long killer frogs are small. They have an armor class of 11. They'll have 1d8 hit die, 30 feet on land, 60 feet when swimming in the water. I'll also give them, you know, like a 20-foot jump. But your key difference here, you can look at the giant frog as a sample, but obviously a giant frog is up to 6 feet, and it has the, you know, grapple, swallow effect. I don't think a 2-foot killer frog would have that, but they've got their teeth. So I'm going to give these killer frogs 3 attacks, plus 3 on the attacks, a 1d6 plus 2 on the bite, and 2 1d6 plus 2s on the claws. Those pluses are in there because, you know, it says they're razor sharp. So if they hit you, it's going to do some damage. Now, one thing you'll notice if you go into the Dungeon Master's Guide and you look up homebrewing monsters, they tend, when they do these challenge ratings or whatever, they have high hit points and low attack. Whereas I'm having something with, you know, 1 hit dice, but look, it gets 3 attacks. You know, the average is this is going to be something like 14 points every turn if it hits. But of course, it has this low hit dice. And, you know, armor class is not that hard. So, you know, players are encountering them. They're probably going to be killing them. Depends on their initiative. This is my personal preference. If you want to use the DMG, give them high hit points or low effect, you know, that's fine. So if you look at the original Blackmoor stats on the frogmen, it is super confusing. They say that they have the same stats as mermen, which in the book Blackmoor are notoriously slim. AC of 7, 1 hit die, and armed with slings and crossbows. Now, what's curious here is that the mermen have already been represented in the box set, where they're described as having the same stats as berserkers, only their own -1 when fighting on land. And they are armed with trident and darts. Whereas the frogmen in the Temple of the Frog are armed with a trident and a net, which curiously is the same armaments that they get when they are again represented in the first edition Monster Manual. Whereas the mermen in Blackmoor have only the slings and the crossbows. Totally confusing. So, instead of trying to figure out the different versions and what should make sense, I'm just going to make up my own frogmen for 5e. They're said to be much more powerful than killer frogs, so I'm going to make them 3d8 hit dice. I'm going to give them a plus 5 to hit, and again, I'm going to give them a bite and 2 claws. 2d8 plus 2 on the bite, 1d8 plus 2 on the claws. Now, that's a lot of damage. I get it. That's a nasty thing. But remember, they're going to be spread out through the complex and whatnot. The players aren't going to meet, you know, 240 on the Breeder Island like in the original book. All right, so the bandits are going to be just out of the book, you know, bandit captain and standard bandit. Then you have the townspeople, and I use town kind of loosely. It's, you know, a collection of like riffraff and camp followers for the bandits. They feed people. They repair the clothing. They have armorers, this kind of thing. you know, they provide a, you know, tavern type booze and comfort to the bandits. And I would have the, you know, second in command bandit, the captain, as kind of the mayor of this town. And you got your, you know, tavern keep or your blacksmith or whatever that you may want to roll up and have some stats on. If the players have a chance, maybe they infiltrate and come, and they come through the town and meet these townspeople first. Although again, the, you know, captain of the guard under the control, if he sees the players immediately, he's going to communicate this to everyone else. Now, the last thing we need to think about in terms of setting this module up before we actually go in, as I said, and draw up our maps and figure out where everyone is the rings of control. This is the piece of technology that makes this whole thing work. It's what allows Stephen and Barnabas to take over the temple, you know, convince these druids that what they're doing is good, control areas of access, and control the bandits who control order in the town. So in the book, as I said last time, the rings are hierarchical, and, you know, the higher the ring, up to the prime ring, which Stephen has, they control all the others and have all their capabilities. And, you know, this control, this command over those beneath in the hierarchy of rings is never explained or defined. You know, was there a saving throw when someone puts on the ring? You know, does this control last forever? There's no chance, you know, occasionally to get another save? Or what if, you know, the higher ring says for the lower one to do something suicidal? The rings are said to have instant communication between them. How does this work? You know, do the higher ring always cancel out the lower ones such that, you know, you're not just having idle chatter constantly between rings, sort of like a party line in the old days. No one can hear anyone, what's anyone saying? You know, and in modern D&D, control magic is charm person is much more limited, a command spell limited, a dominate spell. You know, a geas, you know, forces someone to do fulfill some action, but it doesn't give you total control over them. You know, and items have to be attuned in terms of rings. There's ranges on things. And then if someone does manage to break free from the ring's control, do the higher ring wearers suddenly realize that someone has broken this control? And of course, if the players defeat Stephen and they have access to the rings, the power belt, the teleport thing, can they use them as well? Because they're going to want to. All right, so in terms of solving the issue with the rings, as I said in the last video, I'm going to reduce them. I think there was 96 or something. I'm just going to reduce these to, say, 10. Number one goes to Stephen, of course. Number two goes to Barnabas. Number three goes to the leader of the temple. Number four to the bandit captain underneath Barnabas. And then we go to the rest of the five priests and maybe some more, a couple more bandits. You might want to add one or two to some non-priest keepers of the frogs. And again, these rings control, these are created by the alien technology of Stephen. The rings control the killer frogs and the frogmen. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to have these rings control, they're powered by the teleport device, right? This is the power source for the power belt that Stephen wears. You could have it also for you know, his sword and shield if you want. And I'm going to give the rings a sort of hybrid between a charm and a geas spell. Once the wearer puts this on and they have to make a wisdom check, a DC 25, they've decided that the higher ring wearer's interests and suggestions are totally correct. They are aligned with the lower wearer's interests and they will be carried out unless those suggestions are going to bring harm to the lower ring wearer. Or if they take damage from a higher ring wearer, they get another save. And the rings have a range of 1 mile from the teleport cube, which also provides this instant communication. This communication can always be overrided by a higher ring wearer if they're demanding that they go to a specific person. All others are cut out of that specific person, so Stephen has the ultimate control. If for some reason the teleport cube is destroyed, the rings don't have power. So this makes these rings very powerful. They have a high DC to resist, but not all powerful, because Stephen and Barnabas and whatever have to be careful about the commands they issue, the instructions. You know, they very carefully, you know, worked in this idea that these killer frogs and these frogmen are aligned with the druids, you know, dislike of civilization and promotion of the swamp. And this control has to be recharged. Once every 30 days, a ring wearer goes to the teleport cube, sits inside, you know, and comes to an understanding with the frog gods, right? So it's not a permanent thing. If someone, a ring wearer, goes over 30 days and they don't get the recharge, they are free from its effect. Okay, now that I have my disposition of the forces and understanding of, you know, what Stephen and Barnabas, how they got here, what they want, you know, and what their objectives are. Now I'm going to draw my maps that are going to reflect this new, you know, this new improvised story that I've created. So obviously there's going to be, as I say, you know, the, some of the areas are going to be ruined or whatnot or overgrown. And I'm going to make the decisions how the players might stumble across this Temple of the Frog. And that'll be my next video. But until then, if you like what you've seen, please subscribe to my channel. Leave some comments. I love to read them and respond. And most importantly, keep playing D&D and tell somebody else about it.